clearly, from an IATA perspective, the situation is fragile but uneven for the aviation industry. So the American carriers are doing very, very well at the moment in terms of profitability, and they're enjoying the full value of the drop in fuel and also the strength of their own currency. But in other parts of the world, it's not such a rosy picture. And here in Asia Pacific, we've got a situation where there's been a lot of capacity coming into the market, and that has pushed prices and fares down. We've seen the rise of the Gulf carriers over the years. We've seen the rise of the LCCs, many different forms of LCC all coming in, and an increasing competition within our markets. And that's pushed fares down. We've also seen a lot of market uncertainty with globally, with things like Brexit, the recent election of Donald Trump. It's very, very difficult to call the way that the markets are going to go these days. We've had 7 years of pretty solid growth, and that's been good, but no one really knows where it's going to go from here. Where is fuel going to go from here? There's a lot of uncertainty. The only certainty that we have, thankfully, in our region, is that growth is set to continue. And the challenge is actually how to make money out of that growth. And I'm really delighted that we've got Khun Charamporn and Peter here today, because of course all of you will be aware that they're in the midst of restructuring their businesses in the face of changing market challenges. So I think they're better placed than anybody to offer their insights to us as to what works and what doesn't work in a changing market. The key to all of this is innovation. And we've heard about turning solid urban waste into jet fuel, which I think is a very exciting innovation from Cathay. There are many other innovations that we see in our marketplace, and Andy referred to the massive different classes of travel that we have coming out of our marketplace in terms of meeting differing passenger expectations and needs. So the way we're going to run this, I'm going to ask for a few comments from each of our panelists for sort of five or 10 minutes, and then we'll get into a discussion, and then towards the end I'll ask you, the audience, for questions. So please get your questions ready for the end. But I'm going to begin by asking Shukor, the founder of Endau Analytics, a famous financial advisory group. I'm going to ask Shukor for his comments on energy prices, fuel, the state of the industry, where you see airlines and aviation going from a sort of financial perspective. So over to you.
Thank you, Conrad. First of all, thank you to Andy and AAPA for inviting me to share some insights with these two very eminent gentlemen. Thank you also, Jimmy Batista and his team, for wonderful Filipino hospitality. I'm a Malaysian, and we've always marketed ourselves as Malaysia, truly Asia. And when I flew into Manila yesterday, I flew on Cebu Pacific. But I tend to realize that it's more fun here in the Philippines. So, but coming back to the outlook for next year, I think from our side, I come from a credit rating background. So my interest, our interest is mostly in aviation economics, financing, and so on. So the key risks we see for 2007 as we approach 2017 are four or five key risks. And this includes a volatility in U.S. interest rates next year and what that will do to the cost of money, cost of borrowing for airlines next year, and how that will in turn impact on the market in general. Geopolitical issues, number two. To some extent, number three, the uncertainty surrounding Brexit, because Europe is a huge source of revenue for many Asia-Pacific carriers, and I know Malaysia also, and Thailand especially. But at the same time, we see a lot of strength for Asia-Pacific Airlines going into 2017 in terms of their ability in the past few years to manage capacity, to be nimble, to be innovative. And I think those bode very well for the industry in this part of the world. I do think that Asia-Pacific carriers are going to be at the forefront of changes within the industry and also to lead the industry as a whole. Well, we're not sure how energy prices are going to impact on the market. It is very low, and I think that has had some very good results for the airlines. But how far those prices will stay at those levels, we don't know. I mean, our projection is that it's definitely going to be low for the first half of 2017. Jet fuel probably not more than $70 per barrel. But then again, you know, the risks are there for any geopolitical reasons, and then that could just change very quickly. But at the same time, with low oil prices, there is also a difficulty in managing currency risk. A lot of our carriers in the region, Malaysia, Thailand, even Singapore, are seeing their currencies being severely impacted by the strengthening US dollar. So even with the rise in the decline in oil prices, I think it doesn't do very much to help these airlines to earn the kind of benefits and profits that we should be seeing. So that's again, you know, up to people like Peter and Khun Charamporn to manage. Risk management in airlines is probably one of the most difficult challenges for any industry because it's constantly changing. I think the job of an airline CFO or CEO is probably one of the most challenging, most tricky in the industry in terms of having to manage so many different variables. You just don't know where the next problem is going to come up from. But having said all that, I think we're very cautiously optimistic that things are going to be extremely stable, notwithstanding the economic difficulties that some of the big countries, emerging markets, are facing within ASEAN, Asia Pacific, China, India. I think they present opportunities for airlines that are undergoing restructuring, like MAB and Thai. And as a Malaysian, I think we're wishing very well for you, Peter, to help MAB sail through in what has been a very, very tumultuous and difficult problems over the past few years. So yeah, in a nutshell, I think, you know, it's looking not terribly good, but I think our industry is resilient. I think the outlook, especially for low-cost carriers like Cebu, whose share price is, I looked at it the last few days, is probably the best performing among all the airlines in the region. And I think it will stay that way because, you know, it was the first time I flew them yesterday, and just the vibrancy and the bubbliness of low-cost carriers, and you see the same with AirAsia, for example. So those are the kind of things that would attract future travelers, and we have a lot of travelers below the age of 35, and these are the people that's going to determine the next few years.
So you're seeing interest rates going up, US dollar strengthening, which of course for our industry is a nightmare because all of our costs, fuel, aircraft, maintenance, are all defined in dollars, which is a real challenge. But you're also seeing opportunities, and you're talking there about low-cost carriers and their share prices. And it's interesting because it makes me think of Qantas, who have seen their share price increase by, I think, threefold as a result of successful restructuring there, which is a nice segue into Khun Charamporn. We had the quarterly results, I think it was last week, and I think there was an 80% improvement quarter on quarter, which is fantastic. So what's the outlook and the challenges that you see for Thai going forward?
Well, for Thai Airways, we're still only about halfway through our restructuring. If you look at our ability to sell, if we want price time quantity, the price-wise, I think we managed our yield reasonably well, but the quantity, our killing factor is still fairly low compared to the industry average. So there's some commercial side that we have to being doing better. Also on the cost side, there must be about almost 10 billion baht that we should be able to get rid of these fats. So this is about only halfway through. But if you ask me what are the challenges, you're right. I mean, is a airline is a risk management business. And actually, it's similar to my past life, or past background of being a banker, a treasurer of the bank, and then the stock market. I mean, mainly is the risk management. The bank, the airline to me, just before I joined, one of the things I see right away is one of the most mismatched as far as the asset and liabilities. Your asset is such a long period of your aircraft is 12 to 17 years old. Once you decide to buy an aircraft, you're stuck with it for, by the time it delivers, 3 to 5 years, and you normally keep it for 12 years. So it's about 17 years asset. Once you decide that, but look at the environment. It changes every month. If you look at the key drivers of demand, I can only talk about Thailand, but I can tell you that the growth is not by chance. There's someone drives it. There's a driver, such as the some of the regulatory. When Japan decide that from now on there's no the Thai does not need any visa, suddenly the traffic just grows tremendously to Japan. And just recently, there's an announcement from Canada that from now on, the Thai does not need a Canadian visa. The traffic will grow to Canada like crazy. But when, as an airline, I look at my fleet, which aircraft I want to fly to Canada nonstop? I look at our fleet. Our fleet has 787-8. Oh, that's the right aircraft. But we don't have crewless on a dash 8. But this is pure risk management, you know. So once you know that what you need to do on the aircraft, that means I need a pretty high portion of aircraft to be a flexible one. I can go long haul, I can go regional, etc. If I have that tomorrow, I could go to Canada pretty easily. So you're right. I mean, there's a lot of risk involved. The regulatory, such as the visa, will be one thing. And China also. When Thai announced that from now on, Chinese does not need any visa. You can come to have visa on arrival to Thailand. It's great. I mean, the traffic flow was jumping from like about 3 million passengers per year to 9 million. And this year is probably approaching 10 million. But then what happened? We had a call from, complaint from our passengers that they've been sitting at the carousel and the baggage was running around and around because the last flight, the passenger does not arrive at the baggage claim yet because at our immigration, they're stuck there for 2 hours because of the traffic, the visa on arrival. So a lot of infrastructure was not there. So I believe as soon as you see any change in any regulatory or anything, all the supporting entity will have to be carefully planned because otherwise you end up stuck in some position where you cause unhappiness and you are not able to capture the full opportunity. But if you ask me what are the toughest challenge, is that the growth in Thailand in Asia are very high, especially Thailand. But at the moment, Thai Airways are not able to capture the flow. The flow are going through the Middle Eastern carrier. I mean, that's a fact, and we don't have a good strategy yet. We have alliance, like Star Alliance, but both sides of the continent, both European carrier and the Asian carrier, are in a defensive position. I think we both have to think about what are the proper strategy. I don't think we have seen that yet. I mean, we have come up with a good strategy yet. Yeah.
That's very interesting indeed. Thank you, Khun Charamporn. And it really, that whole story of really long-term investment in infrastructure, in people, in aircraft, against an extremely volatile short-term climate, I think that's one of the really big challenges for risk management within airlines. You're absolutely right there. I think the Japanese example is very interesting as well, because of course, I think it was 2013 when the government set a target of 20 million inbound tourist arrivals by 2020. And in fact, because of the low yen and because of relaxation of visa restrictions, particularly on Chinese and Southeast Asian nationalities, they hit 20 million by 2015. And then they raised that target to 40 million by 2020. So the visa has a massive impact on growth in travel. Talking about aircraft, and this brings me on to Peter. One of the challenges you've had is that as the restructuring began at MH, you're actually dealing with A380s in your fleet of aircraft. And this is a fascinating aircraft, because I was in Dubai about a month ago with Tim Clark, who's the president of Emirates, and he actually wasn't that glowing about the A380 anymore. And I wonder, of course, they've got the biggest fleet in the world, so one assumes they can get the scale economies from that type. But you've had to deal with what to do with an enormous aircraft in a turnaround mode, and I'd be very interested to hear from you on that.
Yeah, Tim was probably negotiating with John Lee for better pricing, so that was a tactic to talk it down. So, just before I talk about the A380, my kids and wife were in Manila last weekend. I had to work, and they came back and said, "Dad, you're going to love Manila. It's really cool." So, and I got to the airport, and I truly, for the last 2 days, I have never seen so many people smiling since Ireland beat England in a rugby match a couple of years ago. So it's just a wonderful city. And this event, there's no time wasters at this conference. Every decision maker, almost the whole of Asia Pacific, is here, and very senior people from the manufacturers. So congratulations. It's a wonderful event. It's brilliant. On the A380s, we have six of them. I describe them internally as spaceships. They're not really aircraft. They're like the space shuttle or something. I have learned more about that aircraft in the last 12 months than I wish to learn about anything else in the rest of my life. We've just completed, or we're completing, the fourth big C check and 70 modifications on our A380s at the moment. We weren't able to find anywhere else on planet Earth actually to get the work done, so we've had to do it ourselves. As each aircraft has been going through the hangar, I'm a bit of a geek. I went down, the scaffolding's up, so you can crawl all over the whole aircraft. I don't know what they were planning to do with the aircraft when they built them. They must have thought they were going to turn them into aircraft carriers. But they are put together in the most incredibly strong way. They're showing no signs of wear and tear, really, other than well-publicized technical issues on the aircraft. I think they're going to be a bit like the Boeing 707 that are still flying in America for military use today. I think that a lot of A380s will still be flying in 40 and 50 years' time, and there'll be many different uses for it. For us, it's too big for the London route. It's got four engines. It's thirsty. There's a lot of erosion of yield on the routes to London from Asia and other places. So we've leased some A350s. They start arriving next year. It's a lovely aircraft. I was looking, spoke to all the obvious people about selling the aircraft. I think a secondary market of the aircraft, it's too early yet for secondhand sales. We've been using it for the last couple of years, every day an aircraft to operate the Hajj and the Umrah business to Saudi Arabia. The Umrah is a shorter version of the Hajj, and it goes on for about 7 to 8 months. It's growing incredibly fast all over the world, and the Saudi government has targeted up to 30 million people to travel on the Umrah over the next 10 years. So we've decided to create a separate carrier that would specialise in operating the religious pilgrimage traffic, not just from Malaysia or from Asia, but from right around the world. The aircraft will be refitted with between 650 and 700 seats. It will be at a very competitive seat cost ratio on that. The traffic on the Hajj and the Umrah is entirely pretty much predictable for the next 20 years. The Saudi authorities are getting far stricter on the age of the aircraft and the type of aircraft that could be operated into their airspace. And I think there's a great opportunity for a secondary market for the A380s, not just the six we have, but I think some of the other aircraft that will come off lease over the next couple of years. Just another point I'd like to make. I'm over 30 years in the tourism and travel business. And I wish I was 20 years younger, not just for life reasons, because I have never seen an opportunity in all my years, a wonderful opportunity as the Asian carriers have at the moment. China and the tourism outbound from China is a little bit to me like tourism out of the UK and Germany and France and the Netherlands was 40 years ago.
Yeah.
Only 4% of people in China have a passport at the moment. The government has a target that 12% will have to have a passport within 10 years. That's 150 million more people who will start taking vacation trips over the next 10 years. And where are they going to go? They're going to travel immediately within the region here first, because that's where they'll go for the first few years, because history shows us that's what Europeans did and that's what Americans did when they start getting passports. I actually think the problems are a little bit different. If you take a short-term view, I'm very conservative about currencies and about fuel. That's the way I was taught in my previous life. So I think you hedge 12 months out, even at a horrendously high price, you hedge your currency, you hedge your fuel, you take out all that risk. Tough if you end up hedging at 130, whatever, that's the way it goes. I think the bigger challenges we're going to have in the region actually is we won't be able to get enough pilots. I think there's about at the moment in the region 70 narrow-body aircraft parked in the region because there's no pilots to fly them. Okay, people are pretending, people are hiding it, but that's the truth of it. I think there's not going to be enough hotel rooms. I think the investment in hotel and resort and theme park and attractions infrastructure isn't happening quickly enough in Malaysia, in the Philippines, in Indonesia, in different areas around that. There's a time lag in development of airport infrastructure as well, definitely. There's big shortages of runway capacity, and I could go on and on and on. So the opportunity, though, is enormous for the carriers. And people are seizing it quickly here. People are buying wonderful new aircraft that are actually going to bypass over time some of the stuff that the Gulf carriers are doing. So I could go on and on.
Yeah, that's very, very interesting. And I think the point about the infrastructure, about hotel rooms, is very well made. I was hearing Spring Airlines talk last week about the fact that they've actually purchased a hotel in Japan to make the best of slots at Nagoya. Because firstly, they couldn't get slots anywhere else into Japan, and then when they wanted to go there, the only way that they could accommodate their passengers was to have their own hotel. I mean, it's absolutely extraordinary. So infrastructure is a really major issue.
And history shows us that when TUI Group started up out of Germany, they had to build their own hotels in the Canary Islands. They actually built resorts.
Yeah.
They've sold them off subsequently, and they've got out of that business. But history would show us that that's how the industry developed over time. And then SAS did it as well. And they actually, at one stage when they sold it, the hotel chain, it was probably the saving of the airline. So I think there's a model there that we probably have to follow.
Mm. The other thing, Peter, I heard you talking the other day in Singapore, and you were talking about the possible consolidation of sort of short-haul operations between low costs and what have you. What's driving your thinking on that?
There's far too many low-cost airlines in the region. They don't have a critical mass, many of them, and they are going to hit the same challenges as that sector hit 20 years ago and 15 years ago in the States, and has hit in Europe over the last 7 or 8 years. If you don't have scale, it's fine for the first 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 years. Then you start hitting into heavy maintenance challenges. There's a big shortage of maintenance MRO facilities, capacity. That starts getting very expensive. Your first few years, you've got great deals from the manufacturers, etc. There's too many of them chasing too few slots and too few passengers at one level of it. And I also think they don't have the scale that when you grow up, it's very easy to get to 25, 30 aircraft, to go up to 80, 100 and 120 aircraft. That's when it starts getting tricky. And when the fuel price, which it inevitably will go back up, and I'm guessing it's already going back up and it'll edge up, I think that's when the shakeout will happen. I think the challenge in the region is there won't be the rationality of the consolidation that you might get in other places, because you've got personalities involved and you've got some really, really massive personal bets have happened with people with all their net worth tied up. So I think that's going to be difficult. I think conventional corporate finance deals would be hard to do, but lots and lots of airlines in Europe and the States went bust overnight with somewhat of a shock to people, and I think that'll happen in the region. It could be next year, 3 years, 5 years, but the consolidation will happen.
Yeah, and I think what's interesting is fuel could well be the deciding factor, because I think if you go back to the former sort of prices of fuel 2 years ago in India, for example, then there would only be one profitable sort of short-haul carrier. I think it would put all the rest of them into the red. So I think you're absolutely right there. Shukor, what's your, talking about business models, I'm going to ask Khun Charamporn in a minute about Thai Smile and Knock and the part that Thai Airways Group, but where do you see consolidation coming, or what's from a financial perspective, what's your insight there?
Well, I do see consolidation coming. I think I read a report last week where Willie Walsh and Sir Tim Clark were talking together about the disappearing of alliances in 10, 20 years, even sooner, according to Willie. And I agree with him. I think that, you know, there's less need for those sort of things. But as far as business models are concerned, I think in this region we've seen many different types of business model. It's evolved considerably in many markets. Again, you know, I speak of MAB because I live in Malaysia, so I'm closely following that. Malaysia has evolved from being a full-service, long-haul, premium carrier to what it is today. And I have no doubt that I think you have other ideas on how to craft it into something more nimble and more profitable in the next few years. In Thailand also, we're seeing some changes within the way you run your operations and your strategy. I'm not sure if you know the Knock Air has done any how shall I put it politically correctly done any been profitable to you, but again, I'm not in a well position to talk about that. But I do see some consolidation within the region. I mean, you see Indochina with what Vietjet is doing, for example, in Vietnam. Fabulous the way they're taking number of aircraft. I'm just not convinced if that's the way to go. It does worry me to see when an airline takes an aircraft every month, and I just wonder how they're going to pay for it. But I think the cost of borrowing next year will remain low. I think there's a lot of money flowing around next year. But the carriers that are going to be strong, as it has this year, would be the low-cost carriers. If we have the example of Tiger Air, Scoot Air, and Scoot, sorry, which have been doing phenomenally well for the past year, and I stand corrected, but I think it's done even better than the parent airline, in general. And we'll probably see that in many other parts of Asia-Pacific as well. I mean, I mentioned Cebu Pacific, whose shares have performed extremely well, and in many ways doing better than the flag carrier as well. That's the reality of it. We see the flag carrier suffering. SIA not suffering terribly, but I think, you know, it's undergoing, facing a bit of turbulence, Cathay Pacific as well. But that's part and parcel of the changing dynamics of the landscape. There is a paradigm shift in the marketplace from where it was 2-3 years ago.
Yeah, and I think it's interesting because the low-cost long-haul model that was touted maybe 5 to 7 years ago and then kind of died down with high fuel prices, that's back again. So I understand AirAsia X, for example, are sort of planning a major long-haul rollout with long-haul low-cost, for example. So I think we're going to keep seeing people coming in and trying to innovate. But I think, as Peter said, the real question is whether they'll survive for the longer term. And I'd be interested to hear from Khun Charamporn about your experiences with Thai Smile and with NOC and the various iterations there.
Well, for NOC, the name of the game now is re-engaging. Whereas in the past, when we started NOC several years ago, the market was quite new, not too much competition, so they were doing quite well. They make profits steadily, but as competition increased and the low-cost penetration in Thailand, probably among the highest in the world, is 53% now, and so the at the moment, in the past couple of years, NOC having some financial, they make some loss, etc. But in the past, since we let them do their business, let them compete in the low-cost arena, which is at Don Mueang Airport mainly, for us Thai Airways and Thai Smile in Suvarnabhumi, they were doing well before. But now, as the cost efficiency, etc., will have to be pretty close to the competitor now. So Thai Airways, which never cooperate on operational and other things, we'll have to rethink, and now we are re-engaging in two fronts. First, we start to use our economy of scale in negotiating with the MRO, with a lot of thing to improve efficiency. On one front, the other front is on the commercial side. Whereas before, we say, okay, NOC Air, you run at Don Mueang Airport. And since we thought that by having different airport, you don't need any network connection. But in reality, if you look at in Japan, ANA, domestic in Haneda, and international in Narita, and today, most of the traveler that come to Thailand spend 10 days. If you spend 10 days, then when you fly elsewhere, you don't need to come out from the same airport. So you'll be seeing a lot more of an interline agreement, etc., or co-chair among Thai Airways. So there'll be possible of 27 more destinations popping up on our internet screen with NOC Air. So that's what we have to be helping them, and I think by doing so, both of us could be stronger. So I view this as a temporary setback for NOC Air. But as far as Thai Smile is concerned, it's quite clear it's still a full service carrier, but an efficient single fleet operation, only short haul 320s, only A320s only.
Yeah, and that way it keeps the operating costs down, seat mile costs. It's very, very interesting, and I think the whole development in Thailand on the low cost side has been interesting with a lot of different permutations in that market. But Malaysia, you've got Firefly. Any plans to sort of expand those operations, or how does that work?
I think the short haul business in Malaysia at the moment, so even in Ryanair, we never got into the lunacy that's going on there. So that can be sustained maybe for a year or two more. You know, it'll go on, and there's people battling it out, and that's all very entertaining watching that. There still is a big chunk of people in Asia, and it's been very interesting for me to watch it, who want to travel in business class.
Yeah.
There's a lot of people who don't want to sit with people in economy. There's a lot of people in all over Asia who have a certain status in life, and they're quite happy to pay the money, whether they even have the money or not, or they're often not paying for the tickets themselves. We've noted a lot of Chinese people, when they're going on vacation, they want to travel in business class as well.
Yeah.
But to go back to the key global tourism megatrend is China at the moment. So everybody in the room here has the potential to get a good shot of this extra 150 million people. There has never been in the history of tourism a new market of that many people has grown in that short space of time. And I actually think the problem is there's going to be nowhere for them to stay around the region. I actually think that's the demand supply problem we've got. That's actually going to be a challenge for the airlines.
Yeah.
You know, we're going to have to be working very closely with tourism authorities, hotel groups, theme park attractions, and it's a sea change. This is what happened, as I say, 30, 40 years ago across Europe. There's an airport on the west coast of Ireland called Shannon, which grew up over the years, and I knew the man who really got it going. And his theory was you had to create something to pull people out of the skies down into your airport. So he found ruined castles and he did them up, and he pretended that they were heritage sites, and people had banquets and kissed stones and drank all night, and all around it they built hotels and golf courses and pretend pubs that never were pubs, that old Mrs. McGinty's place. And you know what? The airport grew within a few years. So it's happened all over Europe in resorts. It's going to have to happen here, but those people want to fly somewhere. And I don't think we need to worry about low-cost long-haul, because the longest haul most of them will be may Orem Kui or somewhere, which is only 6-7 hours flight away. So it's not really long-haul. I think the opportunity is enormous. I just wish I was younger to be here to enjoy the fun over the next 25 years, 30 years of it developing.
What about one thing, talking about the distribution of seats, we can see that Asia packs slightly different, because the customers in general are a lot younger. They're a lot more e-connected. We've had all sorts of, I don't know what you'd call it, shenanigans in Indonesia with various online travel agents, Traveloka. Where do you see the distribution going? What are the challenges for the airlines for distributing? And maybe we get some ideas from Shukor first on that, from a sort of financial investment perspective.
Yeah, well, you're right, Conrad. I think the demographics of Southeast Asia, for example, we've got population of 19 million in Vietnam, for example, and you know, you're looking at 35-40% of that are under the age of 35, and they're driving the growth in that marketplace. Similarly in Indonesia, and also to a certain extent in Malaysia and Thailand. And I think these are the group of people, the millennials, if you like, who are going to determine where the next phase, the next growth will come from. I am convinced that it's low cost. Discount travel is the way forward. That's not to say that there's no place anymore for business travel. It's just shrunk. Some business travelers are down trading to cheaper products. And we've seen that with Cathay, with Singapore Airlines. But you know, there's still a reservoir, a catchment of especially in Singapore, which is still a very strong financial center. But overall, I think what's going to drive seats are the young people traveling. And internet has played an incredible role in transforming the way we look at travel. I mean, you can just pick out your smartphone and just book a ticket to fly tonight or any time of the day. And that is the huge advantage that, or could be a disadvantage we're facing in terms of embracing technology, and also in terms of marketing, and where traditionally in the last few years we've seen low-cost carriers like AirAsia and and Cebu been fantastic in exploiting that.
I think it breaks into two sects. So I think business travel in Asia very, very dependent on the travel agents.
Yes.
And I don't see that changing here because the culture here in Asia is quite different, and a lot of that has to do with corporate governance and graft and avoiding that and everything. So I think they're very, very important, and they will be for the longest time. So the carriers that are selling through that channel will have to get really slick and find better ways to reduce their GDS fees.
Yeah, that's right.
And around that. Then for everybody else, I think it's that.
Yeah.
I don't actually think by the end of next year it'll particularly matter if your website's any good. I just think as long as your mobile works properly. I was leaving, my wife asked me what time the flight was. I couldn't quite remember. My son, 13-year-old, spoke to Siri and asked, what time is the Malaysian Airlines flight to Manila tomorrow? And it spoke it back to him.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's the world we're in. That I think if you're not really on your game, which a lot of people aren't yet, and the low-cost carriers are much better at it on mobile, they're going to eat your lunch. But a lot of the full-service carriers are catching up on that quite quickly.
Yes.
And they may well have the resources to sustain that over a 3-5 year period. So they'll catch up quite quickly.
Mm-hmm. And I think, and as you say, they have to, because it's survival in that part of the game, I think. And really, the distribution side of things has changed in some elements very much, but in the corporate travel area, not really at all. And in fact, I think still the majority of corporate travel agents favour the sort of old-fashioned existing channels, and that's really what their customers want. What do we think the changing passenger expectations are going to be for air travel going forward? The new travellers coming into this market, what are they really looking for?
I think they want fun.
They want fun.
Yeah, I think at my age, when I fly and I see it's how remarkable it's changed. Like cabin crew on Cebu on AirAsia, they're just so bubbly and so vibrant. And when you go on traditional flag carriers, with the exception of a few, you don't see that kind of excitement. And what's driving young people these days is just they just want to have fun. They want to get on board a flight where they can enjoy having a rapport with the cabin crew.
Yeah. It died.
I think it's dead.
Yeah. Sorry. Thank you. They want ease of booking their flights. I think they want less hassle. And that's something that traditional flag carriers, FSCs, are perhaps struggling still to modify or to get closer. So if you get the bulk of the volume from the, and this is where CEOs like Tony Fernandez has been incredible in capturing that market, for example, and then they know. You can just see from the number of followers on his tweets. So he's done that exceptionally well, to the extent that AirAsia benefits from young travelers or even senior travelers who are just wanting to have some fun. And I think that's missing in many of our traditional carriers these days. I mean, you just don't get it. I mean, you know, it's bad enough. Some of the aircraft are probably aging a bit, but I think it's... it's ripe for a change.
Yeah. Khun Charamporn.
Well, I believe the next wave is the FIT from China. And I had an opportunity this past April to be in one of the CEO forum at Microsoft. And there are four business person, and they're two very young. I mean, those are the newly up and coming mobile related, etc. And they said the new generation of Chinese, they already gone surpass want to own something, you know, as like want to own luxury goods. They want an experience instead. So rather than buy a Louis Vuitton, they want to go out to the rest of the world and experience what they have been seeing on their mobile or chats or whatever that the others were doing. So you'd be seeing a lot more of the FIT coming directly from China. And these are the generation where they research on their own, they listen to the social media, etc. And they will find some strong place everywhere in the world to go. So I think the channel that we need to have is just to make sure that you capture, because all these are very high-end. Actually, they are young, but they do have money. Yes. So I would say mobile for sure. And then I don't think they're going to be targeted low-cost airline. So I think for full-service carrier, we still have some opportunity, I think.
Peter.
Yeah, I think it actually spans everything. I think up front, people are looking for something really posh, really, really fancy in the business travel now. I think a lot of business class on a lot of the carriers in Asia is better now than the first class was 10 years ago, way better, actually. What we haven't seen yet in Asia is the ultra, ultra low-cost airlines, like who really, really are absolutely no frills, because they are kind of still kind and sweet to you here, even in those carriers. I think we will see somebody emerging who will pick up a fleet of 8 or 9 or 10-year-old Airbus A319s for peanuts, or you know, NGs, 700s and 800s, they'll be picking them up for $6-7 million cash and flogging them to hell, and they'll actually disrupt the low-cost segment a bit. I think that'll happen. And I think in between then, the one thing I also see is that none of us, the carriers, including ourselves, although we're working on it, the carriers generally are very poor about general tourist product sales. Yeah. Okay, the ancillary revenue here, people say it's, you know, they call it that, but selling a bag, it's selling a meal or something. But a lot of carriers have done very well, Allegiant in the States, Ryanair in Europe, EasyJet, in selling you, you know, they can have conversion of up to 5-7% of car hire and hotels. But the hotel and car hire offering you get in the booking flow is incredibly relevant to your journey.
Yeah.
And they're also brilliant at giving you vast amounts of superb tourist and travel information about your destination to get you go there. Something we did when I was working in Ryanair, we had this thing on the front page where give us the dates, and so you put in a range of dates and how much do you want to pay, and rather than you saying you want to go to X, it would suggest places to you that, you know, are available on those dates for $20, right? You know, a lot of people, and then when you clicked on that, it would go off and it'd show you the hotel and the car hire with it as well. And like, you'd be amazed the number of people who had go to a website, had no idea where they wanted to go, but when they get hit with all that stuff, they'll do it. So I think, so it's going to be a range. And I think if you're an airline, you have to address some of the seats down the back of the aircraft, as British Airways do very successfully in Europe, at a low fare. And then up front, you try and get the maximum amount of fare you can out of there. And we could touch on frequent flyer schemes for hours.
Yes.
They are very important as well, and they will be increasingly important because they marry in perfectly with data mining and the ability of personalizing the experience in a website.
Very, very easy. We're almost drawing to a close, and I'm aware that everybody wants to get to lunch, but are there any questions from any members of the audience? Just put your hand up. Yes, Junbong.
Maybe just a point of clarification, and I thank Shukor for highlighting what Scoot and Tiger has been able to do, and we are seeing quite good growth in that segment of our portfolio of carriers. But as at this point, the parent carrier is still carrying the bulk of the group's performance. So we are talking about in excess of 80% of the profit, even based on the latest profit, is coming from still the parent carrier. But it is correct to say that the LCC segments have been growing much faster. Just a point of clarification. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for that. Are there any other questions? One of the things that I found most interesting talking to both of these gentlemen here was the issue of culture. And it's exactly the point that Shukor, I think, brought up, which is really there's an element of fun which passengers are looking for, and engagement, and staff are looking for as well. And interestingly, Khun Charamporn was talking about the need within Thai, as the restructuring goes forward, to change from a sort of a farming attitude to more of a hunting, more of an aggressive attitude within the company. And then Peter was talking about bringing back the sort of staff support activities like sports activities and barbecues and lunches. And I think that it's often a point that we overlook when we're looking at turnarounds about how you bring the spirit back into an organization. And on behalf of the audience today, I'd like to thank all three of our panelists for all their insights. I think it's been very, very interesting. And I'd like to wish Khun Charamporn and Peter every success as we go forward. I think you're both looking at break-evens next year and profits in 2018. And I'm sure you're going to get there. And on behalf of everybody, I'd like to say a big thank you. If we could have a round of applause for the three panelists.